Okay, hello everybody. welcome to another paleo art session with myself, Christopher DiPiazza. I hope I can see the comments this time, but we'll see about that. So today we are going to do one of the dinosaurs as usual that we voted on. This past week we voted on two very bird-like dinosaurs, and the one that won is called Anzu. And most, if you've been watching these videos for a long time, since the beginning at least, which I believe was in, I want to say April or March, oh yay, the comments are working. I can see the comments, which is nice. So I usually have a toy of that dinosaur on hand to just show you like a little reference before we get started. And the creature that we're going to be doing today, the dinosaur we're doing today, is called, it's not really a very mainstream dinosaur. It's not very often sold as a toy. So, but because I'm really, really nerdy, I actually do have a toy of this creature. But you thought I was going to say I didn't have a toy of it. Ha! Tricked you. But I do. Everybody can get a toy of a T-Rex or a Triceratops, but how many people do you know that have an Anzu, right? So, this is Anzu. Anzu is in the same family as a dinosaur that maybe some of you might be more familiar with, called Oviraptor. Many of us who have dinosaur books and things like that may have read or heard about Oviraptor. So Anzu is a member of the Oviraptorosaur, we call it, family. So it's very closely related to Oviraptor. And as you can see, it was very bird-like. In fact, if you didn't know better at first glance, real quickly, you might just think this is just like a weird bird. But it's not a bird. It's very close related to birds, but it's not a bird itself. It's a different kind of dinosaur. The first thing about Anzu that you should probably know that makes it very different from any known bird is that it was very large. This was a very big dinosaur for being so bird-like. I believe it was over 10 feet long, or close to 10 feet long. If I remember correctly, I believe that's how long it was. So it was quite large. It would have been taller than any human. It would have been able to look down, right down on you. And as you could see, it was covered in feathers. Now, the thing about Anzu is we don't actually have any feather fossils. We have bones from it, but we don't have any real feathers preserved in the rock. But that doesn't mean we can't assume it had them, because we have other Oviraptorosaurs, which are dinosaurs very closely related to this guy, that did have actual provable feathers in the fossil. So if they had feathers, there's no reason to think Anzu didn't have feathers. If Anzu didn't have feathers, it would be a weird exception, and we can't really assume exceptions. So it almost certainly had feathers in life. It had a long neck, and on the tip of that neck, it had a beak with no teeth, and it had a big crest on the head. And these guys, there's some confusion or debate about what these guys would eat when they were alive. Some people think that they were just plant eaters. Some th people think that they were just meat eaters. Some people think that they were omnivores, which means they ate plants and meat. They did have very powerful muscles in the back of their jaws, kind of like a parrot. The parrots have a short, toothless beak, and they can crack open hard nuts and things like that. They have a very powerful beak. So these guys may have been doing something similar to that. They had wing feathers. We know they had wing feathers because we have nests with eggs from Oviraptorosaurs that are closely related to this guy, and we even have fossils of the parents that died on top of the nest. So, and the way that the mother or the father Oviraptorosaur died was sitting on the nest with their arms out, and that pose is done by birds today, and the only reason why that pose works is because there's feathers on the arms. So the parent is using their feathers to spread over the nest to protect the babies. Although if there's no feathers there, there's pointless for that pose is pointless. So these guys probably had long feathers on the arms like birds do today. But unlike many birds, they also had three big long fingers with claws, hooked claws in the end of them. A few birds actually still have their fingers with claws, but not many. Long legs are probably very fast, and at the tip of their tail, they had a long tail, which is not a bird trait, and on the tip of their tail, they had a special bone called a pygostyle. And birds alive today have a pygostyle. It looks like a little triangle, and that's where tail feathers grow from. So, you remember when I was saying, like, we have direct evidence of Oviraptorosaurs having feathers? Well, you can have evidence of feathers without seeing the feathers. So, Oviraptorosaurs had a pygostyle bone on the tip of their tail, and that is specifically meant to attach tail feathers. So we know that these dinosaurs almost certainly had tail feathers on the tip of their tail. Even though we don't see any feathers in the rock, they wouldn't have preserved. Feathers are soft, they usually don't. But we have evidence that they would have had them. So that's pretty cool. So let's get moving on this feathered dinosaur of ours, Anzu. Oh, by the way, Anzu is a the name sounds pretty interesting. It's not a typical name. Usually you have things like raptors and sauruses. Anzu is a name from ancient Mesopotamia, which is a place in the Middle East. If any of you are in middle school or have been to middle school, they typically teach about Mesopotamia. And Anzu was the name of a god or like an entity in Mesopotamian religion, which was basically an eagle with the head of a lion. So this dinosaur is actually named after a creature from Mesopotamian mythology that was half part eagle and part lion. Eagle body with a lion head. So it's kind of cool. All right, so let's get started with this this drawing. Oh, one more thing, just a reminder, and I'll remind us at the end. I will be present at Field Station Dinosaurs in New Jersey, in person on August 15th. I will be wearing a mask, and I'll be standing over 6 feet away from you, but I will be there. And I believe there's still tickets available. So if you want to get in on that, you're welcome to come join us. I'll be drawing three dinosaurs that day. Okay, cool. So let's get started with our Anzu. Let's see. Let me move the computer a little bit. There. Okay. Cool. All right. So, Anzu. Anzu had a very short head, and then it had a long neck, and then it had a torso. The hips were here. And we're gonna do this guy running. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so so this is kind of gonna be the basic pose for Anzu. And there we go. Linden says hello. Hello, Linden. I believe your mom asked me to do a drawing for your teacher, and instead of mailing it, I'm just going to bring it to the park on April 15th. I'm assuming you guys are going to be there. So I'll have it for you then. But anyway, so here's our sketch here. My favorite dinosaur is Triceratops as well. Triceratops is a solid favorite dinosaur. Good job, Charlie. You picked correctly. This is our basic outline. And so it has a short head, long neck, a gentle S curve to the neck. The neck wasn't so flexible, it wasn't like a swan's neck, but it did have a gentle S curve. The arms are going to be here. Now, keep in mind, most of this arm is not going to be visible. I'm just putting the foundation down. That's why I'm doing it nice and light because we're going to put feathers over this. All right, so let's start with our head. So, Anzu, whoopsie. Had a big crest on the top of the head. It's kind of like a upside down U shape. And then it had a beak. And the beak kind of went curved down. And the bottom of a beak kind of was almost kind of duck-like. It's odd. And then it kind of went up again, and then the tip of the mouth kind of went down again. And then the lower jaw would have been down here. But this guy probably would have had a pretty extreme overbite, because if there was extra keratin growing off of the top layer of the beak, it would have probably engulfed most of the bottom jaw. And then the eye socket, the eye was about here, I want to say. Maybe a little bit more forward. Here, I think.
I think I'm gonna lower that eye. That doesn't look right. Let's see if I put it here a little bit better. Yeah, that looks better. Yeah, the eye was a bit lower. Okay, so there's the eye. The nostril was about here. And then the jaw went up here, but there would have been some muscles back there, so the bottom of the head was here. So there's our head so far. And just keep in mind, if I'm going too fast, that's okay. I am not going to slow down because we have to finish this whole thing in an hour. So in order to do it in 1 hour, I have to go at a very specific pace, not too slow, but not too fast. So if this is too fast for you, that's fine. That's great. You can go to the YouTube video right after it and you can watch it again and pause and rewind. Right around in the drawing is where inevitably someone pipes up and tells me to slow down. Maybe they hadn't seen the other videos where I say it every other time, but I'm saying it now. I'll probably have to say it again later, but unfortunately I cannot slow down. I have to go at a certain pace. But that's okay. All right, so here's the top of the neck, and this guy would have had feathers. So, but the feathers would have been kind of smooth down, I'm gonna say. And then the bottom of the neck is gonna be right there. Great. Because there would have been some meat and skin. It wouldn't have just been like outside of the vertebra. All right, now let's get moving on this arm. So there would have been some skin between the forearm and the humerus bone. So the humerus bone is the top, like where your bicep is, and the forearm is like here. So on the elbow of this guy, there would have been some skin here. And we know that because birds have it. Okay, so there's gonna be this piece of skin here. And then we're gonna go into the claws. Now, the way wings on or feathers on dinosaur arms work, and we've probably done this before when we did Velociraptor and Stenonicosaurus, is some people, when they draw dinosaurs with feathers, they just draw the arm and they just draw feathers like growing out of like this part of the arm. But that's not correct. We know, thanks to a lot of fossils that preserve the feathers in various dinosaurs as well as modern birds, that the feathers actually grow out of the second finger. So they would have been growing out of this finger. So this third finger isn't even going to be visible. It's going to be completely covered in feathers. Okay? The only finger that's going to stick out is this one. So I'm going to put the big hook claw there. And then we're going to start drawing our feathers. And you do that by doing these little like kind of curvy wiggly pattern. And feathers overlap. They're kind of like shingles on a house. And the way they, if you want to get very detailed, they're the feathers overlap from the inside out if you're looking at the outside of the wing. So there's that. So there's like the first layer of feathers, and then there would have been some longer feathers, and we call those primary feathers. They're the feathers that birds basically use to fly to get off the ground. That would have been much longer. So we go. Beautiful. There's our beautiful Anzu wing. Now remember, Anzu wasn't flying. It was too big and heavy to fly. This thing was like 10 feet long. But it still had long wing feathers, and that's because feathers were not originally an adaptation for flight. Birds today modified their feathers from, you know, when they were flightless, to fly. But dinosaurs have had feathers long before there were birds, and they use them for all kinds of things like keeping warm, communicating with one another, camouflage, taking care of their eggs and their babies. So you'll see a lot of different dinosaurs had feathers that didn't fly and never were going to fly. Their ancestors didn't fly, their descendants didn't fly either. Okay? Only one group of dinosaurs flew, and that was the birds, but a lot of other dinosaurs had feathers too. So here's these big wing feathers. Let's go into the back. The back is going to be mostly smooth. And we'll go into the tail. And the tail is going to have those big feathers in the back too, which are very similar to the tail feathers on a modern bird. Looks like a big fan. Then the tail is going to go into there. And there's going to be another layer of feathers on the top there. Beautiful. Cool. Now we're going to go into the legs. So this leg, the thigh for the leg that's closer to us, is mostly covered by that wing. So you don't have to draw it. Don't have to worry about it. But I'm going to imply where it's here. The way I do things, my brain works. When my brain works, is I like to just outline where it would be with my pencil, just so I get an idea, and then I kind of start where the kneecap would be. And then here's the calf, where the shin is, and there's a big muscle right there. If you ever eat a chicken, like a whole chicken or a fried chicken, there's what we call the drumstick. That's what this muscle is right here on the calf. And then there's the ankle. And Anzu had long legs with long feet bones. That's what these are. And it would have walked on its toes like most dinosaurs did. In fact, I think all dinosaurs did. Like all dinosaurs did, I should say. We've talked about this many times. I think we were talking about this on our very first lesson. Uh-oh. There we go. And here's the other toe. And there would have been some toe pads here to help spread the weight. And there would have been one more toe on the other side that would have been mostly covered up. And then, if you'd like, you can put these little scales. I'm going to erase this part here because modern birds have this too. Many modern birds do, at least. Little scales here that go all the way up. And in certain dinosaurs, those scales are made from the same material as feathers. And by that, I mean birds. And in other kinds of animals, like alligators, they're made of a different kind of material. And lizards have it too sometimes. They're made of a different material. Even armadillos have it, which are not even a reptile. So there's no reason to think that all kinds of dinosaurs had similar scales. This guy did come from feathered ancestors, so it's very likely that it had scales similar to that. Maybe it didn't. We don't know. It's allowed. All right. I'm going to do some feathers, some like more wispy feathers on the leg here. Actually, you know what? I'm not. This is a relatively large animal, so maybe it wasn't extensively covered with feathers. That's like a modern bird. So I'll put the feathers up closer to the thigh. And I'm thinking of ostriches when I'm making that decision. So modern ostriches are a little smaller than Anzu, and they don't really have feathers on most of their leg. So maybe Anzu was similar in that matter. Okay. Now we're going to go into the bottom, and I'm going to give Anzu like a nice big waddle. We talked about waddles when we did Therizinosaurus. There we go. That's cool. Looks like some extra skin under the throat there, maybe used for display. And the feathers are going to start again down here. And then the chest is going to go here. And let's do the other leg. So the other leg, the knee is going to be all the way up here. This guy's going to be running. Shin's going to go down here. Here's the middle toe. Here's the two side toes. Here's that little, we call that the hallux. Where's that little extra toe that's kind of high up, that's kind of evolved out of commission? Most birds don't use their hallux for much. Some do. So, like for instance, roosters use their hallux. Their hallux is quite long for fighting. Eagles and Hawks, they have the hallux that comes all the way in the side, and even perching birds, many, actually, I shouldn't say most birds. Any perching bird uses the hallux, but ground birds typically don't. A lot of dinosaurs did not. Some did, but Anzu really didn't use it for much. Erase that sketchy foot that I originally put. Okay. And then I'm going to put the other arm. I'm going to draw out this arm. The middle finger was longer than the other ones. So there's the whole arm. And then there would have been feathers growing out of that. Okay. And there's feathers going here. That's good. And then here's that piece of skin that grows on the top. All right. So there's our Anzu. Looking good. All right. So I'm gonna apply some feathers on top of the head here that are growing around the beak and the crest. And I'm going to draw like a circle around the eye, implying that there is some skin there. I'm going to go in and erase some of these extra lines. Rid of all my sketchy lines here. Okay, so there's our Anzu. Now I'm going to go into the shading part. I usually, the past couple months, I've forgotten to shade before the paint. I didn't forget this time. So I'm going to go start with the eye. I'm going to shade under the eye a little bit. I'm going to definitely shade under the top beak, chin. This waddle is going to have some shadow. The crest. Oops, I forgot to erase some of these lines on the crest here. Shade on the underside of the neck. And the way I do the shading is I imagine if there is a light on top of shining down like the sun on top of this animal, where would the shadow be? So if the sun is coming from here, the shadow would be on this side. If the sun is coming from here, the shadow would be on that side. So you kind of imagine where your sun is going to be coming from, and then you kind of draw your shadows in. Shading underneath the fingers here. And the feathers, the hind foot or leg, I should say. The toes. There we go. This would have some shadow under there. Going to put more shadow on this because the shadow from there, this wing is going to be casting a shadow on the leg as well. Okay. I'm gonna go over these wing feathers again. Darker. So they stand out a little bit more. There's also gonna be a shadow on the bottom of the chest. Not as dark as the one on the leg, but there would still be a shadow there. There. Okay. I think that's good for our shadows. Yeah. Right, great. Let's change our station for painting. So here's what I have so far. Don't worry, I'm going to give it a pupil later on. I'll draw the pupil in. But that's what we got so far. So looking good. There's the wing feathers, one arm's out, one arm's back. I don't know what this guy's doing. Maybe he's making a turn or something. Or she, it could be a girl. Here's the feather t the fan on the tail, long legs for running, long neck, relatively short face. This guy did not have a long snout. All right, here we go. Gonna put that flat, rotate the camera, get my paints. Go, and the big water jug. Boom. Okay. So this guy, I'm gonna use a variety of colors on this. And we're gonna use a little bit of inspiration from modern birds, or I am at least. You can use whatever color you want. Excuse me. But I'm also going to use some original colors too. Right, so I'm going to start out with yellow, bright yellow. And I'm going to paint the beak and the corner of the mouth, as well as the crest in this bright yellow color. And again, you can do yours whatever you want. That's what I'm doing. Then I'm going to take red. And I'm going to paint the wattle red. And around the eye is also going to be red. There's going to be like some skin around the eye. Okay. Then I'm going to go into like the arms and the legs with like a bluish gray color. I'm going to start at the hands. And then before that dries, I'm gonna go into like a pink color for the inside of the arm. And the reason why I'm doing that is because if you look at modern birds, the underside of their wings, especially big ones like ostriches, the underside of their wings don't have too many feathers on them sometimes, and you can see the skin. So I'm giving it like that pale pinky bird skin color. Same thing for the legs here, thinking about ostrich legs. And I believe I did a similar thing with our therizinosaurus, with the legs. All right, and then as the legs get further down to the foot, they're going to get more grayish orange. Make them a little darker. Oh, that's actually literally the same color. There we go. A little darker, a little bit more gray. Now, birds, and therefore dinosaurs, probably had all different kinds of feet. So if you look at birds alive today, some birds have. A lot of people just always assume birds have yellow feet, because I think chickens have yellow feet. But a lot of birds have all different kinds of colored feet. There's birds with black feet and gray feet.
There's pink-footed birds. There's a bird that actually lives around here sometimes. It's a migratory bird. It's called a water thrush. And they live in the eastern United States, and they migrate through in the spring and in the fall. And they have pink feet, bright pink feet. Some birds have blue feet. You might have heard of a blue-footed booby. They have blue feet, but other birds have blue feet too. Toucans have blue feet. I don't know if you guys knew that. So birds can have all kinds of interesting colored feet and beaks too. All right, so we got a yellow beak, some red around the face, got gray feet, pink legs, pink arms, and like gray hands. So far we have a very colorful dinosaur. I'm gonna go back to the head, and I'm gonna mix a very dark, almost blackish, greenish blue color. And I'm going to paint the feathers around this guy's face and head this rich, dark, bluish green, greenish blue, whatever you want to refer to it as. The cheek will be that color as well. Work my way down the neck. And again, you can do yours whatever color you want. Doesn't really matter. Feathers come in a variety of different colors, and they get those colors different ways. So certain kinds of feathers can only be certain colors. So for instance, like downy feathers, you're not really going to see like blue or green downy feathers usually. Those are usually feathers that are a little bit more what we call advanced. But we know Oviraptorosaurs had those kinds of feathers because of their wings and their tails, so they could have been this bluish color. And the blue is obtained by sunlight. Without the sun, that it wouldn't appear blue. So if you want to do an experiment, I don't know how, actually this experiment would be difficult to do, but like if you go to the zoo and there's like parrots in outdoor enclosure, you could see like blue parrots or blue parrots especially. In the sunlight they're blue, but if you take a parrot feather, a blue parrot feather, and take it like like hold it directly up to the light, it turns brown, or it looks brown. So the blue that you're seeing is like the sunlight reflecting off of the feather, and that's why they kind of look shiny too. You can see it on like some modern birds, not modern birds, some local birds too, like starlings and crows. They have that look to them. It's pretty cool. Alrighty. So the head and the neck is going to be that rich blue color. I'm going to use a slightly bigger brush. And I'm going to do like a brownish color for the some of the body. So I'm mixing red, orange, green, a little bit of blue to get this like rich brown. And I'm going to start doing the, so I'm going to start with the arm. I'm going to do the top of the wing. And then I'm going to do the back. Go down the tail. Then I'm gonna go to the base of the tail. Go. All right, now I'm gonna take a more yellowy brown, yellowy orange brown,
I'm going to paint the tail feathers that brighter yellow color. Now, some colors in feathers, like yellows and oranges and reds, are there because of something called a carotenoid. Carotenoids are things, are little microscopic things that grow on feathers that are a result of the bird eating certain foods, whether it be insects or sea creatures or even certain berries and stuff. And because they eat the certain diet, this substance goes into their feathers and it makes the feathers appear a certain color. A really good example is flamingos. Flamingos eat brine shrimp, and the brine shrimp that they eat cause their feathers to turn pink. So if a flamingo doesn't eat brine shrimp, it's not going to be pink, it's going to be white. So in zoos, they feed them brine shrimp. I don't know what form actually they feed the brine shrimp in. I think they might feed them like a diet form, like a pellet form, or maybe they feed them live brine shrimp. I don't know. But they do look pink in zoos because they're still getting access to that substance. So maybe Anzu was eating something out of the river or the water. Maybe it was eating like shellfish or something or shrimps because its beak was great for cracking. Maybe it was eating certain fruits or berries. We don't know. Or maybe it obtained that color a different way. Because feathers can be different colors a lot of different ways. Right, so there's my overall color scheme for Anzu. I'll hold the paper up for you. So it's like blue and red and yellow, brown. Pretty cool. It has a little white ring around the neck. I don't know if anybody recognizes this color scheme. It's not exactly based on this bird, but I was thinking a little bit about a modern bird when I was doing this color. I was thinking about a pheasant, or specifically a ringneck pheasant. And ringneck pheasants actually live in America. You can find them on the East Coast, but they're not native here. They were brought here from Asia because people like to hunt them. But they're still here because they didn't actually hunt all of them. Some of them escaped and they had babies. So now they live here as an introduced species. So I was kind of thinking of a pheasant. Male pheasants have this dark bluish green head and the red around the eyes and the yellow beak, and they have a very different looking tail than Anzu did. But I was thinking a little bit about pheasants when I did this. I don't like to do my dinosaur colors exactly based on modern animals, but sometimes I'll do like a little touches of inspiration here and there. Okay. Let's go back. And now I can do some other painting with like more detail work. So now I'm going to take like a darker brown. So mix some red and green together. Little bit of black, not too much black though. You never want to use too much black. And I'll start doing some banding on the wings and the tail. So I'm going to do that by just painting the tip of each tail feather this dark brown color. I'll start with that. Now, this dark color in feathers, like blacks and dark browns, is from another thing in the feathers called melanin. I'm sorry, is it melanin? No, melanin is skin and hair. But this substance is allows animals to develop dark colors. So some animals, like I don't know if you guys knew this. If you think about like a the cat, a Black Panther. Recently, everyone's the superhero, the Black Panther, is popularized. But there's there's it's based on the cat, which everyone calls a Black Panther. I don't know if you guys knew this, but did you know that Black Panthers aren't actually their own species? They're not a real. They're real. They exist, but they're not a species of cat. It's not like a tiger or a lion. A Black Panther is the same exact kind of animal as a leopard, if it's in Asia or Africa, or a jaguar, if it's in South America. So what we call a Black Panther is actually just a jaguar or a leopard that was born with more melanin in its fur than one that, say, is like that light brown color with spots. So what you get is a cat that looks like it's all black. Now, here's the cool thing. If you look at a black jaguar or a black leopard or a black panther, we call them, in the sun, you can still see the spots. It's the same exact cat. So if someone says, my favorite animal is a black panther, what they should be saying is, my favorite animal is a jaguar or a leopard, just one that happens to be black. And if you go to South America or Asia, you'll see families of, like a family of jaguars, a mom and a dad with babies, and they might have a black, one parent will be black and one parent will be spotted. And the babies will be either of those two varieties. So melanin is great for tissue like feathers and fur, and it's more durable. It makes that that body part more durable to wear and to the sun. So a lot of birds have tips of their feathers that are darker colored to help them protect if they're running around and they're brushing against stuff. It's a little bit more durable there. I'm going to take the same dark brown color and I'm going to paint the toes, the toenails, I mean. All right. There's our Anzu. So now we can get working on the background colors. So the environment. So I think we can do like some, maybe some dirt on the ground, maybe some trees or bushes. We'll see where it takes us. So let's start with the ground. Like a darker brown, like a chocolatey brown. And again, as usual, I'm not too concerned about being neat when I'm painting the ground because the earth is not a neat thing, right? There's all kinds of different things in the ground. It's messy, it's hilly, rocky, bumpy, whatever. Try to be careful with painting between the toes here. It's not perfect, but that's okay. Oh, I gotta be extra careful painting between these feathers too now, huh? Oh boy. I have a feeling Anzu here is gonna have a couple dirty feathers. That's just the way it is. All right. Oh, and during this process, make sure the comments in the chat of which dinosaur you think we should do next. It has to be one we haven't done before. So if you mention something that we haven't done, maybe because you weren't here, that's okay. I'll let you know. And you can watch that YouTube video later. But yeah, comment which ones you want to do next, and we'll see if we can do them. We'll put it up to a vote. All right, now I'm doing like a green color for the bushes. Remember, bushes and trees, if you're painting them in the background, you have to put too much detail into them, but kind of make them all messy and squiggly looking up at the top so it looks like leaves. Trees and bushes are never really in perfect circles or anything. They are if people like sculpt them that way, trim them that way, but in nature they're not. That's why nature things are fun to paint to me because you don't have to worry about being too neat. If you're painting like dirt and trees and rocks, you can kind of make them all kinds of crazy shapes. All right, here's the trees behind the other wing here. Okay. Yellow, here's some orange. Mixing more green with other bushes and stuff. On this side, doing some more trees and bushes. Anzu, just so you guys know, is on display at Field Station Dinosaurs in Kansas. New Jersey doesn't have an Anzu model on display, but Kansas does. So that's part of the reason why Anzu was in the running. We try to we'll do dinosaurs that aren't necessarily at either of the parks, but we try to at least put one that's at the park in the running. So if you're near Kansas, you can visit a life-size Anzu, and I believe it has feathers as well, the model that they have there. So that's cool. A lot of times, go to dinosaur park, sometimes they skimp on the feathers, but the one in Kansas does not. So that's good. Okay. All right, now I'm going to go on to the sky. So I'm mixing a blue. And I'm going to do the trick that I do with the let's see. Let me check the comments. Spinosaurus has been done. So if you go to our, oh wow, you said Spinosaurus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times. Yeah, Spinosaurus has been done. You can go to our YouTube channel, see that one. T-Rex was the first one we did. Let's see. Mosasaurus itself wasn't done. We did Tylosaurus, which is in the same family, very similar. Yeah. Okay, cool. So now I'm going to start doing my clouds. So I'm going to do like this big blob here. And then I'm going to wet my brush, and then I'm going to put water on the top of this blob to blend it out, and then you got your cloud. Do this part over here, side of the head there. There's another cloud there, and some more clouds up here. Go. Great. Excellent. Okay. The last thing I'm going to do before I do the outlining is the shadow on the bottom. So I'm going to do that in the dark blue. I'm going to start underneath the foot. I'm going to go that way for the tail. And the end of my shadow is going to have a tail fan too. You see that there? And then there's this, the body, long neck. The wings are gonna be kind of out to the sides. I'm not putting too much detail into the shadow because shadows don't have that much detail. And there's our shadow. Now I'm gonna kind of speed up this drying process up here by taking this wet rag. I'm just gonna mop up some of the excess water so I can get moving on the outline here. There we go. Cool. All right.
Okay, so let me show you what we have so far. Okay, so here's our Anzu. There's the colors, there's the dirt, there's the trees and the bushes in the background. Here's our sky. So now I'm going to get on just the last step before we go. I'm going to outline it with our black pen. And our black pen is right here. All right, first thing I'm going to do is the eye. There's like a little bit of eyelash going on there. Okay, here's the nostril. Here's the beak. The bottom part of the beak. Going to use some squiggle lines to imply some feather texture. So the blue part is the feathers. There's the crest. There's the bottom of the neck. There's the top of the neck. There we go. Great. Okay. Here's the chest, the outer arm, one claw. Two claws, three claws, well, I'm gonna start doing the oop, I'm doing the feathers the wrong way. I gotta start from here. These are the primary feathers. Remember, the primary feathers are those big long feathers that birds use to fly. But this guy probably just used it to protect its nest, most likely, maybe to communicate with other members of its species. Here's the knee, the ankle, the foot. This is the foot here. There's those little scales on the top of the foot. There's the little short hallux toe. Here's the longer toes. Now remember, the toes that dinosaurs used to walk on wouldn't have been that sharp because they would have been worn down from being walked on so much. Okay, so there's the one foot. Here's the other arm with the feathers. Big long primary feathers again. My elbow is being dipped into the paint. That's okay. Not gonna worry about it. All right. Wipe that off. Blue. All right. And then this one finger that was sticking out. All right. Here's the other knee. Here's the calf. Here's the joint where the ankle is. Here's the other toes on the foot. Okay. Now we're going to move on to the tail. Now remember, it's implied that there are feathers all around this brown part, but the way the feathers lie on each other, they wouldn't have looked that shaggy. They probably would have, if you look at the outline of a modern bird, even an ostrich or an emu, even though their feathers are quite shaggy, they wouldn't have been like, crazy lines all over the place. They'd be kind of smooth,
because they lay on the animal's body in a certain arrangement. All right. The tail fan. We go with feathers. I'll make the announcement again, just so you know. I'll be at Field Station Dinosaurs in New Jersey on August 15th. We'll be drawing some dinosaurs. So I hope you guys can make it. I know some of you guys are already coming. And yeah, just remember to be safe, wear your mask, social distance, stay far away from each other if you can, and we'll all be good. All right, cool. Now I'm going to sign my name. All right, and let's look at what we have. Okay, there's our finished Anzu. Looking good. So I hope you enjoyed our dinosaur today. This was a cool one. This is like, I think, no, maybe not. I think Stenonicosaurus fits that description too, but this is like one of the dinosaurs that like not everybody knows, right? Like we've done T-Rex and Brachiosaurus and Triceratops and stuff, but this is one of those guys that like maybe isn't in everybody's roundhouse, but now maybe it is for you guys. So I hope it was like a learning experience for you guys too. I like teaching people about dinosaurs they may have never known about. So yeah, we looks like we got some more requests. I see mammoth, saber-tooth, Utah raptor. So mammoth and saber-tooth are not dinosaurs, but that's okay. We can do them too. We've done Dimetrodon, which is closer to a mammoth than it is to a dinosaur. So I don't see why we can't do one next time, maybe. The kind of pen I'm using is just a, it's a, let's see. It's like a very fine-tipped Sharpie. So I got it at like Michael's or AC Moore. You could probably even get it at like Target or something. It's just a very fine-tipped Sharpie marker. Essentially all it is. It's from a company called Recollections, but honestly, I just bought it because I think it was cheap at the time. So I hope that helps. But you could use a ballpoint pen too if you want. That's okay too. All right, guys, and I'll see you next week. So we'll see what kind of requests we got, and we'll put up another vote. All right, I'll see you then, Wednesday at 4 o'clock.